Hi, I'm Mike Sughrue. I'm a neurosurgeon and co-founder of Omniscient. And today we're going to talk about connectomics and its potential to help us understand the brain and what we can do to help improve it. The first question is, when we think about the brain, how does it work? And the brain is really the most complicated thing in the known universe. There's really nothing that comes close when you really think about the fact that you have billions and billions of interconnections that are firing constantly in very complex ways and having complex interactions and effects on each other. It's not that people haven't been thinking about how the brain was wired up for a very long time. You can see here that this is a localizationist model of the human brain. In other words, it's a model that goes back to the late 1800s when people began to try to think that certain parts of the brain had certain functions. In this case, the Broca and Wernicke model that you see here are showing two parts of what they felt the language system in humans, on the left side of the brain, was comprised of. Now, we know that they weren't way off. We know that these were basically where language is located in the brain, but language is a lot more complicated than this, and we really haven't updated this model. For example, Broca and Wernicke lived in the 1870s and been dead for a very long time, but yet we still teach this in medical school because we haven't replaced this with a much better model. And I think one of the things that we really focus on is that the brain is complex, but we need to have equally complex systems for analyzing it. And what that means is that we can't make it something that's simple to understand just because that's convenient for us. What you see right here are some of the many, many beautiful pictures that you can find on the internet, where you see really the stunning complexity and beauty of the human brain. One of the problems, though, that I found as we began to look at how can you use this practically, is that this really large connection of wires is too complex for an average or even a very intelligent brain to understand. Put quite simply, if the brain was simple enough to understand, we would be too simple to understand it. And so we really need to utilize more complex techniques, particularly ones from AI and machine learning, to begin to dissect this into something that's understandable and usable. This picture is from a Nature paper published by the Human Connectome Project. And what they did was begin to try to utilize sophisticated imaging techniques and sophisticated machine learning techniques to try to define how many parts of the brain were there. This is a question that people have been working on for a long time, dating back to at least 1908, when a man named Brodmann determined there was about 47 areas in his estimation. We now know that the brain is more complex than that. As the Human Connectome Project showed, it's at least 180 areas that are uniquely different from each other. And we've spent a great deal of time trying to understand the implications of a scheme like this, with the thought that this provides an alphabet for the brain. It's a way for us to communicate where, for example, if we're talking about area 8C, that everyone in the world is talking about the same areas, but more importantly, that we begin to understand what 8C means, what its implications are, what do we expect that it's doing, so that we can begin to utilize the decades of science that into how the brain works and bring them to link them to the advanced technologies that we have today to really begin to rapidly accelerate progress in the field. So connectomics comes from the term genomics. And genomics are big data for genes. Connectomics are big data for brain connections. The implications of being able to dissect something so complicated into something that's comprehensible, understandable, and valuable has profound impact on medicine, such as mental illness, where we really had a poor understanding of how this was happening and little ability to study individuals. And now we have the ability to actually visualize it and make actions and hypotheses on what could be going on, but encourage people to think about the more profound implications of the ability to look into the brains of even normal individuals and think, how can we make them better? How can we tackle some of the known limitations of the human brain? And how can we really help people to achieve their full potential?